game remains for George Mason after winning their first BR8C Colonial title. The Patriots try for some additional hardware, the Commonwealth Cup, as Virginia Commonwealth comes to town. It's the Patriots and the Rams on senior night from Woodbridge, and the fun starts now on DMV Stream. From PWI Center, it's George Mason Hockey as tonight the Patriots close the curtain on their season, trying for the Commonwealth Cup against, you guessed it, Virginia Commonwealth. Good evening, everybody. Jeff Arnold joined alongside by former George Mason captain in Brian Bach. Last week was a big one for the Mason hockey program as they were able to capture the BR8C Colonial title in just their second year after moving to the Colonial Division. A major accomplishment, Brian, no doubt.
Oh, no doubt. And if we can see the names on that cup there, there's not a lot of other names on there. That was a huge victory for George Mason. Great for the program. And, you know, great way for Steve Hijack, who brought this team up and raised it from the start. My reason for coming to George Mason to end his coaching career on.
Yeah, Steve Hijack in his seventh year. This will be his final game, as right now you're seeing the goal that was able to give them the win, as it was scored by Alex Mandeville, and just a huge moment for the Mason hockey program. One that had started a long time ago, really kind of started from scratch, didn't have a whole lot of fans, not a whole lot of success, but there you see a lot of happy guys and Steve Hijack right in the middle of it.
Oh, absolutely. Steve Hijack, he brought this program to where it is today. It was a phenomenal win for that team. I was there. I got to see the goal live. It was absolute beauty.
So Steve Hijack getting a win last week is kind of a capper for his career. Tonight, though, is senior night at George Mason. Nick Baker, Alex Mandeville, and Dan Gassel will all be honored before the game. And additionally, for a couple of graduate students, this will be the final game that they play for the Patriots.
Absolutely. A lot of intensity in that. So Nick Baker, wonderful defenseman and great asset for the team. He had a few goals, actually, in last weekend's win, as did Alexander Mandeville. Mandeville, unfortunately, not going to bring that intensity to the ice tonight, though. He strep throat, so he will be out. That's unfortunate. Daniel Gassel, absolute grinder. Look forward to seeing him play.
You know Alex Mandeville tonight for the George Mason side, but VCU, you see, key distributor, that's Robbie Ehler. He's actually not going to play early, as right before his team took the ice for warmups, they learned that he suffered a broken foot after the team's game last night against Catholics, so he won't be there. But Patrick Dillon has been Mr. Clutch this season. He's a senior on this team. Meanwhile, Virginia Commonwealth, they've lost the cup each of the last 2 years, and they're trying to change things tonight here on away ice.
I can't say that I had something to do with that, but I may have had a goal or two that last game. I believe that Mason took it 8-2 in the last cup win, but, you know, this is always one of those games that you look forward to playing in the year. You know it's coming, and it's a very prideful thing winning that trophy.
Let's look at a couple of your key players for tonight's game. We'll start with Virginia Commonwealth. Robbie Ehler is not going to be able to play. We said he's got the broken foot, but Dillon has been one of the top offensive defensemen in the entire BRHC, and he's had a tremendous season.
Oh, absolutely. He's an offensive-minded defenseman, and you know what? They can really rely on him for points and penalty kills.
And additionally, he wants the puck on his stick, and that's everything. That's something that all good scorers definitely have in common. Meanwhile, we look at some of the George Mason keys to the game. After this, Virginia Commonwealth will be playing its conference tournament. For Mason, though, this is the team's final game of the campaign, and they're going to try and send their seniors out with the Commonwealth Cup.
Oh, absolutely. Got to end on a high note.
They're going to try and mirror these seniors' intensity, and they're also going to try and provide a little bit support to Brian Krause, who will be getting the start in goal tonight. He'll be taking the spot of Nick Whalen, who is still going to play, except he's going to be playing one of the forward spots on the fourth line. What should we expect out of him?
So that happens to be one of my favorite things that'll occur. You absolutely love to see a goaltender come and play out of his norm, kind of, you know, give it a try, give it a whirl, if you will. But one of the things you always try to do is get them goals. And it was hilarious. A few seasons ago, we got Keith Fagerquist the goal. We attempted with Nick Whalen last year, but we didn't get it. So hopefully this game we can get him a point or two.
And so Whalen will be seeing probably more time in this game as well than he probably thought he was going to see. That's just because you don't have Alex Mandeville tonight. Let's look at some of the players to watch for George Mason. It starts with Nick Baker and Sevi Cordova. Baker, one of the top defensemen in the conference, while Cordova, the all-time leading scorer in Mason history.
It hurts hearing that statistic, but I absolutely love it. He's brought a ton of intensity to the team, and as you see it from his goals and assists, he's very well-rounded. And he's having a great year this year. He broke the 100-goal record this year. It's been fun to watch.
Additionally, Mason will try and win this game for Steve Hychek, who is very happy after the team won the Colonial last week. And before the game, he was able to catch up with our ringside reporter, Tyler Byram.
Tyler Byram down here ringside with head coach Steve Hychek. So, coach, it's your senior night, too, with these guys. What does it mean going out with this group of seniors?
Well, I got to tell you, it's a pretty special moment for me. 32 years of coaching. I've been with Mason the last 7 years. This is the best season that we've had. Each year we've tried to grow the program and show improvement every year, and this is kind of the crowning glory to be able to have won the championship, to be ranked, and to go out with this group of guys. It's pretty phenomenal.
All right, thank you, Coach. Good luck tonight, and congratulations on your career.
The site is PW Ice Center as we get set for the Commonwealth Cup between George Mason and VCU. Jeff Arnold joined alongside by Brian Bach. It's time to take a look at your Metro DC DJs starting lineups for, first of all, VCU. See Williams, Schaefer, Halligan, Allen, Dillon, and Catherman, a very good goalkeeper who recently transferred to VCU and has given his team a real boost overall. Meanwhile, we take a look at the starting lineup for George Mason tonight. A lot of familiar faces for you, Brian, having played with a lot of these guys before. Who do you expect to have a big game?
I think Cordova will bring a lot of intensity to this game. It's probably one of his last games. I take that back. He'll be coming back next year for grad school. Daniel Gassel, it'll be his last game. A lot of intensity. Tyler Lovejoy, key player. Love to see him out there. He will be playing center on that starting lineup, I'm sure. Ryan Peugeot. Known him forever. Great player, great defenseman. Nick Baker, another great player, high intensity. And Brian Krause, not your normal starting goalie, Nick Whalen, but Krause is a great, great goalie. Bigger guy, takes up a lot of the space in the net. Hard to beat.
Krause is not the normal goalie, as we mentioned. Whalen is going to be seeing some time at the forward position just because they want to give Whalen a little bit of a time off and give Krause some more reps. Is he feeling any additional pressure tonight?
Would that be Whalen you're talking about or Krause?
Krause.
Krause. You know, I don't think so. One of the things about Mason hockey is the camaraderie is great, but for things like practices and everything else we do on and off the ice, everybody's always together. Krause is, I see him stepping up and being just fine tonight.
Well, each of the last 2 years, George Mason, as you see the graphic below, were ranked nationally in the ACHA. And the updated statistics just came out earlier today. Mason finished number 15 in the Atlantic Division, which puts them in the top third of the conference. And that's something that, given where they started, you know, probably 6 years ago, that they're extremely proud of.
Oh, absolutely. I came here in the beginning. Steve Hychek was the reason that I came to the team originally. And you know what? The team has adapted to every new role and just evolved over these years. And as you see it from the statistics, it's been great.
One of the guys that has been with this Mason program since the very start is Morgan Muniza. He coaches the defense here at George Mason, and he will be taking over for Steve Hychek next year. And earlier he caught up with our ringside reporter, Tyler Byram.
Tyler Byram here with the assistant coach, Morgan Muniza. So it's last night for these guys, but also is going to be you taking over the team next season. So how do you see the team going forward after this year?
Yeah, I see, we've got a lot of great momentum at the end of this year. This second semester has been great. We've strung a lot of not only wins, but just playing great hockey at the moment. And, we've got only three seniors, so we're not really losing that many players. So it's really exciting. Got some freshmen coming in, and I'm really excited for next year.
All right, thanks, Coach. Good luck tonight.
Thank you.
There's no question that Morgan Muniza has got some big shoes to fill when he takes over for Steve Hychek next year. What kind of a head coach do you think Muniza will be?
So I actually dealt with him personally because I had started on offense, but towards the end of my career I played back on defense to fill a few holes that they had. But he's very confident in his decision making. He knows what he's going to do before the game even begins. He always has a plan. He goes into it knowing what he expects, and he adapts even if he doesn't see what he expects. Great coach. I've enjoyed working with him the last 3 years.
Stylistically, how much will he be like Steve Hychek?
Style-wise, I would say a little more reserved, actually, than Steve. Steve's been a very animated person. You can tell when there's been a bad call or wrong call with Steve. Love him to death. Morgan, a little bit more reserved, calm, confident, cool and collected.
Well, we want to mention that tonight's game sponsors Glory Days Grill, who is sponsoring the power play, and additionally the penalty kills are sponsored by Dave Stinson Geico. And so tonight, George Mason and VCU, as they're right now cleaning up the ice for the ceremony that will take place before the game. And, Brian, I notice you're rather dapper tonight. You're going to be one of the alumni that gets honored while the seniors will also be introduced.
I will. It'll be fun. It'll be my first time taking the ice and not playing for George Mason. It'll be an interesting feeling.
Well, let me ask you this. When you were in the dressing room for one final time last year, what were some things going through your mind as you get ready to play your final game?
You know, it's funny that you asked that because you never expect it. I played for 16 years now, and when it was that final time to get dressed, it was normal. You know, it was you go through the repetitions, you get ready for the game, you play the game. It took me a couple weeks afterwards to really realize, you know, I'm doomed because it's beer leagues for me. That's it. That's about it.
Are the emotions, you think, maybe drained for the guys a little bit after the game last week that they played where they won the Colonial title? Or do you think there's still some tears and stuff left over?
I think that just because of the flow of things, it's one weekend to the next weekend, that, you know, the emotion hasn't really played its part yet. They haven't really got hit by the fact that in two seasons, Mason has done excellently in the Colonial division, and they won it last weekend. I think it'll hit them maybe a week or two from now.
VCU, they have their conference tournament coming up after this. What has been their style that you have seen in previous years, and how do you think it will kind of go into what they're going to do tonight?
So VCU has always been, I would say, aggressive. I've always enjoyed the games with them. They've always been kind of a rougher type of play, more of your big hits, not so much finesse and lengthening the ice, but they're a tough team.
When you're without your leading scorer like Robbie Ehler, what does that do to your program?
So, you know what? It's tough, but it's one of those things that you just got to work around it. You can't rely on single point of failures like that in any game, really. And I fully expect that coach to realign things and move some people around and create some chances for them tonight.
I see right there some of the guys in the green jerseys. Those are the alumni. Additionally, the seniors that will be honored before the game, they will also be wearing some green jerseys as kind of a way to separate everybody. But there you see the head coach of the George Mason team, Steve Hychek, organizing everything. He really has put his stamp on the program.
Oh, it's crazy how much he does for the program. He, you know, he eats, he sleeps, he dreams Mason hockey, and he does excellently. I can't say, you know, anything bad about him. He has been great for this club, this whole program. It's him that has brought everything that we see today.
When it all got started, the way he described it was this was a team that was winning maybe two or three games a year. There were maybe 10 people in the stands, but since that point, it has grown to be a conference-winning program, one that you saw the graphic just a little while ago had been ranked in the division each of the last 2 years in the top 15. And so he's going out on a high note, and it's a testament to what the vision he had at the very start, what it was able to turn into.
Absolutely. When Steve showed up, I'm pretty sure that we didn't even have jerseys that matched each other. It was that great. We had guys that would come out in almost practice jerseys. And look at us today, you know. It's been a ride.
So there you see Seve Cordova right there, as Cordova is getting ready to come out of the dressing room, as well as some other members of the George Mason team who are preparing for this game, discussing some final strategy before the game tonight against VCU. VCU is going to be playing in its conference tournament next week in the Atlantic Division. They check in with a 14-4-1 record. They're playing on back-to-back nights after they had a win against Catholic last night. But VCU will be without Robbie Ayler, its leader in points, assists, and one of the top overall players in the Atlantic Division. He suffered a broken foot after the game last night, so somebody that everyone on the George Mason side will not have to be too concerned about. And that group of alumni is gradually starting to grow. You can tell them, as we said a moment ago, based on the color of jersey that they're wearing. The green ones mean that they are alumni, while the yellow ones are the active players on the team. And additionally, the seniors that will be honored before the game, they will be wearing green jerseys. But to avoid any confusion, when hockey actually gets underway tonight, they will put on their yellow jerseys. So almost ready for hockey tonight at the PW Ice Center. Starting lineups just a moment ago are brought to you by Metro DC DJs, Glory Days Grill, as well as Dave Stinson Geico. And there you see everybody on George Mason getting ready to take the ice. Now they take the ice. Virginia Commonwealth will follow shortly thereafter, while the officials are also on the ice examining everything. Three 20-minute periods as George Mason will honor a number of its seniors before the game and try and claim the Commonwealth Cup for the third consecutive year. Last year, winning it by an 8-2 score. First 2 years, it was won by VCU. Mason has taken the last two, and so will it go back to VCU or will it be Mason's trophy? As here come the visiting VCU Rams out onto the ice. VCU is led by Michael Fisher, who's in his fourth year as the head coach of the Rams. He played at CW Post, which is an ACHA Division II school, and then he finished out his career at VCU. Noted that this is the first year where he has not coached any of the guys that he used to play with. VCU will be either the number two or the number three seed when it goes to the Atlantic Division, Atlantic Conference Championships next week. As we are ready for hockey tonight, and we will actually send it to our public address announcer, Matt Kraus.
Dan's mom, Kendra, and his girlfriend, Najee, to the ice. addition to playing for Mason Ice Hockey, and Dan is also the current president of Phi Kappa Sigma. Dan will be graduating cum laude this spring with honors with a BS in Criminology, Law, and Society. His studies concentrated in Homeland Security with minors in Intelligence Analysis and Sociology. He is currently applying to different law enforcement agencies in the Northern Virginia region with hopes of becoming a police officer after graduating. Dan is second in games played for George Mason in the program's history. Up next, number 20, alternate captain Alexander Mandy Vanderbilt. Now joining us are Manny's parents, Kathy and Paul Vanderbilt, along with his sister and brother, Brett and Laura Vanderbilt, and his girlfriend, Terry McElhenney. Alex is majoring in civil engineering and is a member of Beta Tau Engineering Fraternity, the American Society of Civil Engineers, and Engineers for International Development. Following graduation this spring, Alex plans to work in the field of environmental engineering. He has been playing hockey since he was 4 years old, over 16 years, when he began as a goalie. His dad was his first coach in youth hockey, and he hopes to coach youth hockey in the future as well. Manny is tied for third in games played, fifth in points, fourth in goals, and fifth in assists in George Mason hockey history. And last but certainly not least, number 19, your captain, Nick Baker. Please welcome Nick's parents, Jennifer and Rick, as well as his younger sister, Karen. Nick will receive his bachelor's degree this spring in applied information technology with a concentration in information security and assurance. He'll be continuing undergraduate school at George Mason in August, seeking his graduate degree in computer forensics. Mason's captain Nick Baker has had a stellar career with Mason. He's never missed a game since joining the team in 2011, ranking as the program's leader for defensemen in every offensive category, to include being number one in games played, third in points, fifth in goals, and second in assists. Nick Baker has also been selected for a second time to the BRHC All-Star Challenge roster, and will compete in the All-Star Tournament in March against other ACHA teams from across the nation. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, please give our honorees and their families a round of applause. So far, your contribution over the years to George Mason Ice Hockey. And now, ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we ask that you please rise and remove your caps for the playing of our national anthem.
So all the pomp and circumstance is over with as the seniors were honored along with members of Mason hockey teams from before, as you see a number of them walking off the red carpet and back into their seats. Brian Bach is walking right there, and he will be rejoining us in just a moment. VCU and George Mason tonight competing for the Commonwealth Cup, the fifth installment of these two teams competing for this cup. As they kind of follow what the basketball teams have done, they compete for something similar every year, and Steve Hychek noting before the game that it has been kind of a carryover to the hockey side of things, as right now the starting lineups are being introduced. There you see VCU. They're gradually getting ready to take the ice. VCU will be without two of its key players tonight. We mentioned that Robbie Ehler will not play. He broke his foot after the team's game against Catholic last night. While he was listed on the graphic that we showed initially, Phil Williams is also a scratch. He's not going to play either. So Nate Ardanowski will take his spot as the left winger on the first line. So no Williams, no Ehler for VCU. Those could be some challenging losses. Meanwhile, for George Mason, they will be without Alex Mandeville, who is out on account of strep throat. We did hear from Alex earlier, but Alex is not going to be competing in this game. And Brian, Alex is going to be a really tough loss for this game, especially when you're trying to go for the Commonwealth Cup.
Absolutely. But, you know, I expect Mason to move some lines around, move some people around, and I think they'll be able to overcome it tonight.
Steve Hychek is on the bench for George Mason. Final game as the head coach of the Patriots before he hands the reins over to Morgan Munizza next year. Hychek was very confident about Munizza being able to lead this team. Coach for part of this program for 5 years, and somebody that I'm sure everybody's pretty confident will do a great job.
Completely agree. Very calm, collected, very intelligent coach.
So if George Mason wants to win this game, how are they going to do it? Well, Steve Hychek had some answers earlier.
Down here once again with head coach Steve Hychek. So, coach, you haven't played these guys an entire year. How are you going to manage the game and going forward against VCU?
Well, obviously what we got to do is work on the little bit of intel that we have. We know they've got a really solid goalie and they got a couple of really good strong lines. So one of the things that we're going to do is make them work to get to our end of the ice. It's our intent to run a coat hanger trap, and the objective of that is to make sure that we get them frustrated in their end, intercept the puck in the neutral zone or in their defensive end, counterattack, score quickly. That's our plan. And in terms of our defensive end, we're going to make sure that we're keeping everybody in front of us and protecting the house in front of the goalie.
Okay, and how are you going to manage getting the seniors ice time tonight with also you want to get a win?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, we'll start like I usually do, making sure we have all of our seniors and our graduate students in the first line that goes onto the ice. We'll then go back to our normal rotation. Certainly when it comes to most of the seniors, they've been around long enough that they are on a pretty senior position, so they'll see plenty of ice time. We have one or two that don't necessarily get a lot of ice, but we're going to make sure we take care of them. Everybody knows that as special as this night is, we're here to win a game, and that's what we're focused on.
All right, hope you get that one tonight. Thank you, Coach.
So we are underway from PW Ice Center, and there is an early save for Brian Krause, who gets the start in goalie tonight for Nick Wayland.
Yep, fully expect him to have a big game and play well for his seniors tonight.
Brian Krause, the junior from Ashburn, Virginia, and with him it's a little bit of a family affair, as the one that was doing the announcements for the pregame ceremonies was his brother Matt, who used to play for this George Mason team.
He did, and you know what? It was great having him on the alumni game. He actually scored on his brother this year. It was phenomenal.
Guiney was not able to get that one to go, and right now VCU is trying to clear out the zone.
That'll be a key thing for Mason to do tonight, is just to keep it in the offensive zone, keep the pressure up. It'll be fun to watch if they can do that.
So it'll be run down by George Mason, gets poked away, and now retrieve as they try and clear it back out towards center ice. There's a pile up for it near the far boards, and then it gets knocked in by Sebastian Richard. This is Lane, and now it's taken
Jack
away
Kelly
by Jack Kelly.
Jack Kelly, one of those freshmen that we picked up this year, he's been a great little addition to the team.
Kelly trying on goal, but that one gets knocked down by Catherman. Catherman recently transferred to VCU, is an excellent goalkeeper. This is Sevi Cordova flipping it ahead, and then it gets knocked on back to center before it can be handled by Edler. gets sent up the ice. Edler will be able to knock it off the half boards. Goes trickling around inside the neutral zone. And Edler will finally control it, knock it on. And this is Cordova, who will flip it all the way ahead into the glove of Catherman, who will cover it up in a faceoff coming our way.
As you saw, Jeff Vegan coming close to the net right there. He's been great this year picking up the dirty goals.
So some line changes taking place right before the faceoff. How has the Patriots' style of attack kind of differed from last year on the first team that was ranked in the division as opposed to this year?
So this year they've actually developed a system where they're playing a trap more often, and they've been keeping it down in the offensive zone as much as possible. And it forces things like this, as you see.
Yeah, the icing is called, and it means that it'll be a faceoff coming up in the VCU end. Now, the trap, it's a little bit similar to a forecheck, but not quite all the way.
So what they'll be doing is they'll try to keep one of their offensemen high in the zone, and as the play develops, if it goes or shifts to one side, he'll move over there. If it shifts to the other, he'll shift across to the other side, and his main job is to not only take shots from high-scoring areas, but also keep that puck in the zone.
One-timer is gloved by Catherman, who's been very busy in the early going. Colin Catherman from Chesterfield, Virginia. He's allowing just a little bit over 3.5 goals a game, and he's provided a sense of stability for this Rams team.
It's great to have a rock goaltender. Everything comes from that. It's tough to work around having a bad goaltender.
Yeah, Nick Whalen, one of the best ones in the BRHC. He will be competing in an all-star game when it comes up in March. Wrister on goal, and Catherman once again has to slide towards his right to knock that one down as that shot was attempted by the captain, Nick Baker.
He's been ripping shots from up there since his time of joining Mason, and you know what? He's buried a couple. I fully expect him to get a goal or two this game.
So the faceoff is controlled by George Mason, but once again, Catherman has to stop there. How do you avoid, as a player that may be playing your final game for George Mason, trying to do too much and maybe play outside of yourself?
I can't give you too much advice on that one just because I absolutely did that.
Because I set you up for that.
Yep, absolutely. It's tough. You just got to keep calm, keep collected, and just play like it's another night.
Joe Halligan will lead it up the wing. And then it gets knocked away by Tarek Zagadi. Guiney able to circle around, tries to center it. Baker had that one knocked down in front. And then it is kept in the zone by George Mason. This one will be sent all the way back. And it'll be left off. And now George Mason, with some line changes, will be able to bring it into the neutral zone. A little bit more than 4 minutes gone here in the opening period. Three 20-minute periods followed by 10-minute intermissions, and then they will bring the Zamboni out after the first and second periods. Out in front, gets knocked away in the slot, and VCU will transition. This is Patrick Dillon. Carlson shovels this one back out towards center ice. And then it gets sent back behind. And then it will go all the way towards the very end boards for another icing.
So he hasn't gotten much play time yet. He hasn't seen the puck yet, but we did have Nick Whalen out on the ice there on the far side. He's playing left wing tonight.
And he'll get more minutes than he was probably planning for, and that's because no Alex Mandeville, as we said. You've tried to get him goals in the past. Has it ever worked?
With Nick, no. We did get Keith Fagerquist, the retired goalie, now goalie coach for Mason, a goal last season. That was hilarious.
Gets sent up the ice again. Pajau with it behind his own net. So far, this game has been played pretty much exclusively in the VCU zone. Be led ahead. Kelly knocked hard into the boards. Stick comes free. And now Sam Klausner will push it out in front. Rister comes ahead into the neutral zone. Changes for George Mason, and we have a whistle and an offsides.
A little bit of confusion there on the blue line. Seve tried to dump the puck and ended up taking out one of his own players.
Seve Cordova, what a career that he has had at George Mason. More than 100 goals in his career.
I am a little bit jealous about that. Great stats, though. Great year. Very well-rounded player. I think he's got 28 goals this year, 25 assists.
Steve Hijik also characterized him as a chirper. This is not Cordova, though, as that one gets stopped after the shot by Kyle Dewhurst, who has moved up lines on account of not having Mandeville tonight.
That was a nifty little move.
He goes by Dewey. Does everyone on a hockey team have a nickname?
If your last name is long, yes.
Lovejoy is able to win the faceoff. His nickname is Lovey, for those of you who are wondering. This one will be sent up the ice. Fight for it. And George Mason is able to win the charge as Baker comes down with it. Lovejoy able to clear it out towards center. This is Egan. Out in front again and gets knocked away by Catherman. Gets sent around the end boards. Shoveled back out towards the blue line. A hard shot is wide of the mark. Nash, that one got knocked down in front. Kept alive. Egan tried to wrap it around but didn't have the good angle. And it gets shoveled on back to center. You have to give a lot of credit to this VCU defense for the way that they have helped out Catherman in the early going.
Catherman looks very comfortable in his pipes right now, so George Mason's going to have to move him and try to move him side to side.
Baker sends that one on goal. Another save for Catherman. Mason will regroup in its own defensive zone. Shields with it now. Sends a fluttering puck on goal, and Catherman will just cover it up. So far, a lot of shots for George Mason, but nothing has seemed to go yet. And as you said, Catherman looking very comfortable in goal, and Mason trying to find its rhythm. Played last weekend, won the BR8C Colonial title, first time that that had happened in 2 years in the Colonial Division. So a big win last week for Steve Hijik as well as this George Mason program. Zagotti will send it towards the defensive end. Now it'll be led ahead by VCU. No offsides. Comes into the slot and then gets knocked against the end boards. Zagotti trying to chip this one out towards neutral ice. And now here comes the race for the puck. Vecchio trying to get it, could not. Mason able to control out at center. Pageau with a drive, missed it wide left. Mason able to keep it in.
Nick Whalen going after the puck. Good to see him out there on offense.
And an offsides is called. So 11:15 left to go here in the first period. Commonwealth Cup between George Mason and VCU. What has been your thoughts so far on this Mason trap and the way they've executed it? It looks like it's been working pretty well.
You know, they played a lot of ice time down in the VCU end already. I think that'll carry on into the next two periods. And I'll tell you what, that goaltender, though, for VCU, he's playing on it, you know, playing on his head, and it's going to take some movement to get him to give up a goal.
There's Dan Gassel going after it, but VCU is able to control. Now, Steve Hijik was noting that Catherman was at the very top of his scouting report. Centering pass, but too wide for Richard. Approaching 10.5 minutes to go here in the first period. Mason trying to make it to VCU, can't get it across even the blue line. And sure enough, the Patriots able to control. They'll get a line change as this one flipped ahead for D'Agostino, but it got intercepted. Nearly a one-on-one, but there Dillon skidded down. Poked out towards the endborns where Kraus will be able to come out and control. D'Agostino on the goal line extended. Good defense again by VCU. Sent up against the half boards, and Catherman will be able to smother. So both teams will be able to make some changes with 9:21 remaining in this first period. On a night that I'm sure for a lot of members of this Mason team is rather emotional, but the nice thing about it, Brian, is that a couple of these seniors will be coming back next year. Nick Baker will be returning. Alex Mandeville, who's not able to play tonight on account of strep throat, he will be returning too. So even though it is senior night, realistically, a couple of these guys for the Patriots are coming back.
I love that they do that too with the offering for a grad school additional year of play. I happened to burn my fifth year myself. It was great, though. I'd love to stay with the program longer.
You know, I'm just looking at my charts, and I'm seeing that the goaltender, Colin Catherman for VCU, he's also a graduate student, so maybe that's the reason why he's got so much comfort in goal tonight. A veteran team, and for Steve Hijack, final night as the head coach for George Mason. And in typical Steve fashion, he doesn't want this game to be made about him. He really wants it to be about this team and especially the seniors.
That's typical of Steve. Steve is very humble, but he gives his all for this team.
Here's Lovejoy up the wing. Centering pass for Dewhurst was too far, but Dewhurst tracks it down in the corner. Knocked down by Catherman. Fight for it from behind. VCU trying to clear. Comes out towards center, but it is kept in by Egan. This is Bayer. Had it poked away, and Shields will track it down beyond the blue line. Delayed offsides is wiped. And now George Mason will charge ahead. Gets intercepted by Schaefer. Fight for the puck in the corner. Lovejoy bringing it up the wing. Sets it up for Bayer. He fires and misses too high. Maybe the best chance that George Mason has gotten in goal all game. Change is coming for George Mason. Vecchio. Bodies flying in the corner. And then it will be sent all the way down, and an icing will be called. We'll head on down to Tyler, our ringside reporter, who has an update.
All right, it's been a very aggressive game so far. Early on, Sevi Cordova and Christopher Allen, number 10 for VCU, got into it very early at around the 16-minute mark. They've been going back and forth. It's getting to a breaking point here on the ice. Something's about to happen, so make sure you watch that matchup going forward.
We'll make sure to keep our eye on it, Tyler. Mason will control. A nice job there by Edler to knock that one away on the forecheck. Shoved on out. Guiney goes down. VCU has got it. Knocked down and a good save by Kraus. Carlson had that one knocked away. Yeah. It'll be retrieved here by George Mason. Gasol trying to go after it in the corner. Comes out towards center ice. And offsides is the call. So far, clean game. No penalties in this first period. But at the same token, no score with 6:24 remaining in this Commonwealth Cup clash. That one sent all the way in, and that goes off the very top of the...
That would be the rafters.
The rafters here. So play is stopped, and we'll have a face-off inside the neutral zone. Dan Gass will be the one to take it for George Mason. And that's something that Mason has done well so far, is they've won a lot of face-offs.
Oh, it's crucial to any game. One of the best probably on the team, and he's still playing for the team, is Tyler Lovejoy. He's always in there. You'll see him in there for power plays too.
Hard hit, but Gasol's able to take it. Feeds ahead for Sevi Cordova, and we have a whistle and a stoppage and a penalty coming up. So a penalty is going to be charged against George Mason.
I believe the penalty's on VCU.
Oh, it's on VCU, and sure enough, it is. As the penalty will go against Ryan Schaefer, a tough guy to lose. Had two goals recently in a game against Radford and going to be relied on heavily for the Rams tonight. And so the power play, the Glory Days Grill power play for George Mason. They'll have the man advantage for the first time tonight. Right after we noted a moment ago that hadn't had any penalties before that. 2-on-1 opportunity for Mason, and that one is skidded wide. Baker retrieves it. And it is a roughing penalty against Schaefer. Gets sent down. Here's Cordova leading the charge. Make it D'Agostino. He goes in, and it gets knocked away by Catherman. Tries to recover. Baker help keeps it in. D'Agostino hits the ice hard.
This is huge. Catherman's missing his stick right now, so they should probably aim for the five hole. He's using a player stick, much, much more thin.
Egan had it knocked away, but it's kept in by the captain, Baker. Gains the line. Baker circles it back out, trying to retreat out to center. Zagatti. Lovejoy fires a pad save and a goal for George Mason. They get on the board first.
Beautiful goal, very talented. I believe Zagatti was able to hit it out of the air there off the tip up from the goaltender.
It was either Zagatti or it was Jeff Egan. Wasn't clear on who the one that got the goal was, but it is a 1-0 Mason lead with 4:23 to go here in the opening period.
Crucial goal for Mason here. It's been going back and forth the whole game. Love to see him in their senior night get the first goal, though.
So Mason is able to put it in. Remember, last year won the Commonwealth Cup by an 8-2 score. It took him a little bit longer to get that first goal, but I'm sure it has to feel good as Catherman is able to glove that one. So some jostling going on, some pushing and shoving between a couple of the players after Catherman made the save. And now the officials have to intervene as it's John Frame and Justin Crawford, our linesmen, who have to come through.
As we take senior night for Gasol, so I hope that he's able to keep his head here.
As we have to take a look, as we take a look at that last goal, and it looked like it was Egan the one that is scoring it and celebrating. Gasol, meanwhile, was called for a penalty. And so he will go to the box.
I believe we'll get a matching roughing call here.
So right now, going 4-on-4. As remember, a penalty was already called on the VCU side. Schaefer, 2 minutes for roughing. So 4:05 left to go, 4-on-4. Brought ahead here by Forrest. And sure enough, you are actually right, Brian. It's Joe Halligan who's also called for a roughing penalty, and so that was the reason for the 4-on-4. You should have noted that the previous penalty had expired. So matching roughing, still 4-on-4 with 3:42 remaining. And a face-off coming up inside of VCU's zone. And they're actually saying it was Cordova that scored the goal, not Egan. So they had to look at the replay, and they found that Cordova scored the goal, so he adds one more to his total. Set over 100 goals in his career at George Mason. So only fitting he should get one more. Lovejoy bringing it ahead. Gets slammed into the wall. Kept in. Centering pass in the direction of Lovejoy got knocked down, but it's kept inside the zone.
One of the key things to do here in the 4-on-4 is to spread the ice. There's so much extra ice.
Kelly being knocked around from behind by Chris Allen, one of the other offensive leaders on this team, VCU club. Shot on goal, too high and over the head of Kraus. Lovejoy. Kelly runs into the referee as a slap shot is defended well by Kraus. 2:15 remaining in the opening period. As you're starting to hear maybe some of the alumni below, and it was pretty well attended down there. For the game, alumni were honored for their contributions to the Mason program. Brian, you were down there as well as you left us for just a moment.
I would much rather be on the bench, though, I'll tell you that. I'm sure a lot of the guys down there with me felt the same way.
I'm sure some of them are probably thinking that on the bench when they come off for their shifts, probably thinking to themselves, wow, this is the last time I'll be able to suit up.
Oh, we've seen it already. Gasol had a penalty there for the roughing, the matching penalty, but he's got some raw emotion going right now. Very intense.
Baker, the captain, brings it across the line. Baker fires, and it's knocked down by Catherman.
Good opportunity by Baker. He's shifty. He's a big guy, but I'll tell you what, he gets around people with that toe drag.
Baker, the senior from Falls Church, Virginia, and he's closing out his season very strong. He enters this game on a 5-game point streak, and this is the thing, Brian, I thought was most impressive about Baker, is that he has not missed a game since joining the Mason team in 2011.
That's amazing. I'm a bit of a Band-Aid myself. I've taken several injuries. Actually had a wrist surgery after one of the games when we played in northern Pennsylvania, but that's amazing. Not a single game missed. No illness, no injury. Lucky, lucky guy.
Fired wide of the goal, and then it'll be covered up by Kraus, and some late pushing and shoving once again. As both teams are back to full strength at the moment, 56.4 seconds remaining. And Sevi Cordova with the lone goal in this game. This is Bayer behind his own goal. And then it'll be sent down the ice where Catherman will leave his crease to flip it ahead. Gasol, really the heart and soul of the third line on this Mason team. somebody that can really wear you down. Set the length of the ice.
Through and through.
Approaching 20 seconds. Sent back out towards center ice. Bayer. Carlson will send it back to Bayer. And I think Mason will be content on pretty much sitting on this one as it's volleyballed out towards the VCU zone. And the first period clock expires. Sevi Cordova providing the lone goal in the opening period. And George Mason will go into the first intermission with a 1-0 lead. So what we'll do is we will take a timeout. It's the Commonwealth Cup, Mason and Virginia Commonwealth, and the Patriots on top. There's your score, 1-0, George Mason with the lead on Virginia Commonwealth. These two teams competing for the Commonwealth Cup on senior night here from PW Ice Center. Jeff Arnold joined alongside by Brian Bach, former captain of the Patriots. And we said, initially our thoughts were that it was Egan who scored the first goal for George Mason. They announced it as Sevi Cordova, and then right as we went to break, they corrected it once they looked at the replay, and it was Egan getting the goal, and Tyler Lovejoy coming up with the assist.
That feels good for Lovejoy. One of his last games of the year already has an assist.
George Mason spent a lot of the first period in its offensive end. I thought they did a really good job utilizing that trap, which has been key for them this year.
Oh, absolutely. They keep that third man high. He watches the play. You know, as it adapts, as it changes, he moves over to whichever side he needs to be on and keeps the puck in their end.
Well, right now what we'll do is we'll go back down to ringside with our ringside reporter, Tyler Byram. Tyler?
Here ringside with offensive coach Tony Cordova. Sorry about that. So 1-0 here early on, but VCU really hasn't been able to get a tack off in the offensive end. What has really helped you guys with your trap style against VCU?
This year we decided to go with like a modified trap. It's helping us out in the neutral zone. It allows our players to pinch them off earlier at the blue line, which is different to a normal trap, which is normally a 1-2-2. It just works out. It makes sure that we have good numbers coming back into the zone and make sure that we're playing a good team defense as a whole. So it's good.
Also, this has been a really aggressive first period. I mean, of course, with a rivalry game, a lot coming with it. It's senior night last night for a lot of players. So how are you guys going to be able to manage that going forward?
That's something we're going to talk about in the locker room. I think VCU as a whole, maybe not quite as skilled as us. So when they take it to the corners, that really helps their style of play. So that's something that we're going to work on. We need to come out hard in the second period. That's just how it is. It should, you know, 1-0 is not the result with the shots that we have that we want. So, you know, we'll address that as we go in there. But overall, I think you'll see a different second period.
Okay, and also, let's talk about your brother, twin brother Sevi Cordova. He's been having a really aggressive first period, and he's kind of one of those moral leaders for the team. How has he been such a big part of this team in the first all season and in the first period?
Sevi is a very unique player. It's interesting to talk about him as a twin. I played with him for so long. He's very aggressive, chirps everybody. It doesn't matter who it is. From a scoring aspect, he's been great. I don't know how many goals he has this year, a lot. But, you know, I think the undervalued part of his game is the physical and mental aspect. He's really gets in there, especially being 5'6". You know, he mixes it up a lot. So that's been something good for us all year. And it's working out right now, and hopefully he continues that for the rest of the game.
All right, thanks. And hope you guys have a great second period.
All right, Tyler, thanks so much. Brian, what I want to know is, does Sevi Cordova ever chirp you in practice?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. He chirps everybody. You know, it's the little guy thing, man. I'm with him. I'm 5'7". He's a better trash talker than I am, for sure. But you hear him throughout the whole game, nonstop, to finish.
He's somebody that wears you down. My question is Tony Cordova the same way as Sevi is, or is that just unique to Sevi's personality?
I don't want to, you know, throw Tony under the bus, but I would say they have a lot in common. I grew up in the same area, Ashburn, Virginia, and I happened to play both of them in high school hockey. 1 year, we beat them and went on to win the state championship for Stonebridge. The following year, you know, they beat us, and they took, I forget which team. It wasn't Langley. It was might have been Loudoun County that they took to the championship, but both of them, you know, I'd rather have them on my team than compete against them. By the end of that game, they wear you down.
So what we're going to do is we're actually going to take a look back at that goal that was scored a moment ago. And initially we thought it was scored by Egan, who eventually did get credit for the goal off of the deflection.
Unfortunately, that almost looks like an own goal. It almost looks like number 3 for VCU might have tapped his stick and gone in.
Well, what they do is they give it credit to Egan, and then they give Lovejoy with the credit for the assist. But either way, it's a goal for George Mason as the body's piling up in front. And I think it was probably difficult for Catherman when you get all those yellow jerseys around you to probably get that vision, be able to turn yourself around and be able to stop that goal.
Exactly, and that's what we talked about early on, or I had briefly mentioned, is that Catherman's very comfortable in his net, and they're going to have to do that. They're going to have to, you know, keep 3 offensemen right around him, move him side to side, and work those angles on him, because those direct shots are not going to work.
He was comfortable in net, but he did allow one through, as the goal by Jeff Egan has made it a 1-0 game. Mason on top of VCU. And we're back here from the PWI Center. George Mason with a first period goal from Jeff Egan to make it a 1-0 Mason lead. And I think, Brian Bach, the big key for Mason is continuing to really hone in on that trap, which VCU had a lot of problems dealing with in that opening period.
Absolutely, couldn't agree more. They need to keep the pressure on and keep the intensity up, stay in the offensive zone and get a few more goals.
One of the things I was wondering about would be how would George Mason deal without Alex Mandeville, who, as we said, had strep throat, so he's not been able to play in this game. But so far, they've done a pretty good job utilizing that trap to get a lot of offensive opportunities.
Oh, they're not a single point of failure team. There's a lot more depth to this bench for George Mason than I've seen in many years.
Brian Krause done a good job in goal. Brian Krause is expected to play maybe this period, and if maybe George Mason can build a little bit more of a lead, then they'll probably go to Ryan Fromignon, who recently joined the Patriots. Shot on goal here. Baker tried to keep it alive, but it gets pushed out by VCU. And an icing will be called as a faceoff coming up in the Rams zone. The Rams, after this game, will be playing in the BRHC Atlantic Conference tournament next week. They are 8-2-1 or 7-2-1, depending on the way you looked at it. It's a little bit complicated because the Rams, one of their conference games against Catholic wasn't properly designated as such. They played them twice, and so the BRHC hasn't decided which one it's going to accept yet. They split the season series, so they are right now either 8-2-1 or 7-2-1 in conference play. What it means is they'll either be the number two or the number three seed in the conference championships next week. And we'll kind of just leave it at that so we don't confuse you any further.
For them, though, I do hope that they do recognize that win because it is a bit different. You know, they may get to play a team that they would rather play in that tournament than whomever has the fourth place seed. So hope that turns out well for them.
Yeah, especially because if you get that two seed, you are able to get the bye. Led out in front, and then it gets knocked away.
Gagne, unfortunately, not quick enough on the shot.
Shields dumps it in. Some jousting going on along the half wall. And Forrest desperately trying to clear the zone, but Mason is not allowing it to happen, and Shields keeps it alive, sends that one on goal, and Zagatti tracks it down in the corner.
We do have a player down on the ice, number two for VCU.
And that's Forrest. Shot coming just wide of the cage. Mason, that trap has done wonders in this game. Fired on by Shields, knocked away. Zagatti once again keeps it alive.
Ryan Pageau puts it at the net.
And it gets stopped by Catherman, who was under heavy fire in that first period, but allowed only one through. And we noted that the goal that he allowed very well might be caused by the fact that there were a lot of bodies out in front. He maybe just didn't see it all that well.
It's true. Puck was bobbling. You never know those situations. It comes down to a bit of luck, really.
So a faceoff here. That was another key in the first period. The number of faceoffs that were won by Mason. They take another one. Centering feed. And then it gets knocked on back towards center ice.
Will Edler, good recovery there.
And Pajau will bring it behind his cage as Mason circles the wagons. Flips that one all the way down. Mason with it. That pass intercepted. And then it gets dumped all the way behind the net. And it'll be poked out by Krause. Good opportunity here for VCU. The shot is knocked away by Arnowski. Arnowski has really been the only one that's gotten any shots on goal against Krause. Another one from him gets knocked down. Comes out near center, and it'll be carried along by George Mason.
Good opportunity here. Fortunately, pass didn't go through.
Baker tried to center. It knocked away, but recovered. Zagatti, his shot was knocked away. Check that, it was Cordova. Sevi Cordova trying to get out into the slot to accept a pass. a knuckle puck on goal almost. VCU trying to clear. And a good play made there by Egan. And we have a whistle and a penalty called.
Egan making some friends early on.
And another roughing penalty going against George Mason. So Patrick Dillon goes down. Dillon took a really hard spill to the ice. As a penalty will mean a power play for VCU, the first time they have been in on the power play. And right now, penalty kill unit will come on for Mason. It's sponsored by Dave Stinson Geico. Face-off, though, won by George Mason. Egan scores a goal, but he's also called for the penalty as he is hit with the roughing call. So that's three roughing penalties so far against the Patriots.
That comes with the territory of the senior night game. High intensity, and everybody's really giving it their all.
Be sent all the way down. Obviously, no icing just because not at equal strength. Out towards center ice. Shields is the one who controls. Flips it on. He was looking for D'Agostino. And Shields will have another opportunity as it gets sent down. And now this is Forrest with it and passes it along. Intercepted by D'Agostino. Gains the line, has some help with Kelly. But good defense played by Klausner.
D'Agostino was a great pickup this year. Great freshman, throwing the hip check. High-intensity player.
Dags, 10th in the BRHC in scoring this year, and he was the conference's Rookie of the Year. Great honor for a great season.
Oh, deservedly. Brought a lot of goals and a lot of intensity to the Mason team this year. Him and Jack Kelly have had a phenomenal year so far.
D'Agostino trying to run it down. Mason remaining very aggressive, even though they are a man down. 27 seconds remaining on the penalty kill. Sent on goal, knocked away. Richards' shot deflected wide by Krause.
Great save.
15 seconds remaining on the penalty kill. Knocked down on the slot. Try to be flipped ahead. Hard knock into the boards. Sent all the way down the ice, and it gets knocked out of play.
You know, it's a good thing that Keith Fagerquist was a goaltender and has great reflexes, because that one was going right for him.
So right before that puck got knocked out of play, the penalty kill expired, so Mason is back to even strength, and we go down ringside with Tyler.
At 28 years old, without a doubt, Ryan Peugeot is one of the oldest players in the George Mason hockey team. The man bun donning Peugeot actually started his academic career at Christopher Newport University, back against the team that George Mason beat last weekend to win the BRHC championship. After Christopher Newport, he joined the military, which forced him to drop out of school for a couple years. When he decided to turn back to academics, he came to George Mason University, and then actually took a couple years before he joined the George Mason hockey team. In fact, on this season, his graduate year, he actually had to be convinced by head coach Steve Hijek to join the team because he had a full-time job and had to balance that with being a full-time grad student. So on top of that, there would have been a lot to balance. I'm sure, however, he enjoys being on the team and did not regret that decision after their emotional 3-2 victory over his former school in Christopher Newport, 3-2 earlier this week.
Yeah, that's a great point, Tyler, and it's one that earlier this week Steve Hijek made, was that he had to talk him into maybe coming back for another year, but once he was able to hoist that trophy, then suddenly rejoining this team, it almost made perfect sense.
Oh, that was a very easy decision, I'm sure. I'm sure there wasn't too much difficulty twisting his arm there to get him to come back.
Baker tries to keep it in. And that's difficult, though.
Here we go.
Opportunity for Mason, and it just misses wide as Carlson had a great look.
Good little move, just couldn't finish it.
A hard shot there by Schaefer misses wide. One of maybe the better looks that VCU has gotten as we approach 12 minutes in the second period. A 1-0 lead for George Mason as that one gets knocked away. Schaefer, another opportunity, kind of alligatored that one. And now Carlson gains the line. Schaefer with it. And we have a whistle and a penalty coming up. And we'll have to see who instigated this one as the stick is chucked aside by Chris Allen of VCU.
Doesn't seem to be very happy with Nick Wayland right now. I'm not sure what started that, but I know that he was holding his stick. Love to see a goaltender in the penalty box.
So sure enough, it is another penalty against George Mason, and so they will go back on the Dave Stinson Geico penalty kill.
Let's see how this develops. They may go to 4-on-4 here. I believe they gave the matching
rough. Did they give the matching roughing penalty? Yes, they did. And so it means that Allen goes to the penalty box as well. As we weren't sure if he was going to go in there for a moment, but indeed we'll go back to the 4-on-4, the second time that we have been in this situation, as there was a matching penalty at the very end of the first period as well. D'Agostino will be facing off, as encroachment will mean someone who has to take the faceoff for VCU. Rams able to win this one.
Like I said earlier, that 4-on-4 play, it's amazing how much extra ice there seems to be now.
D'Agostino bringing it up the right wing. Nick Whalen is a goalie. Don't you, the fact now you're playing at a forward position, aren't you almost thinking to yourself, man, I want to try and, you know, rough somebody up a little bit now that I'm not wearing those goalie pads?
Oh, sure, why not? Take your chances when you get them.
Be led up the wing. This is Dillon. Backhanded shot on goal, knocked away by Kraus. Flipped ahead. Edler runs it down. Be led on by Richard. Richard didn't get much on that one. Pushed away. Able to recover the rebound. And here comes a pass. It was ahead for Cordova. Now they are able to get it ahead. Sevi Cordova, 1-on-1, and it gets turned aside by Catherman. Cordova recovers it now in the corner. Trying to center the pass, but can't. And then it gets flipped on by Forrest back into the Mason zone. And an icing will be called. So 10:13 left to go in the second period. Matching penalties right now have got us into a 4-on-4. It'll be 26 seconds before we get back out to full strength as you look at this opportunity for Cordova.
Looked like the puck started to bobble a little bit. Didn't get everything he wanted out of it.
Also didn't have a very good angle at that particular shot. Baker has got it here on the left wing. Forrest tries to backhand it out towards center. Lovejoy now taking it behind the cage. Lovejoy backhands it into the slot. Be led up the right wing by Schaefer, who fires on goal. That one is knocked away, as I don't think for a moment Kraus knew where it was, but the rebound effort no good.
Looks like it bobbled out of his puck, and luckily he kicked it out of the net instead of in.
Here's Kelly up on the right wing. He fires, and that one knocked down by Allen. Up the ice comes VCU. They gain the line. Drop-off pass for Ardanowski got knocked away. Guiney. And it poked away along the left wing. Centering pass taken away by VCU. 3-on-2 advantage. Klausner fires on goal, and Kraus, who he said it would be a key to this game. How can he fill in for Nick Whalen? And so far, he's defended everything well that has come his way.
That last play has been the only time we've seen any kind of breakdown for Kraus. He's standing on his head right now.
So both teams back at full strength. 8:55 to go here in the second period. battle for the Commonwealth Cup. Last 2 years, it's been won by George Mason. They have the 1-0 lead after the late first period goal by Jeff Egan. VCU trying to bring it into the Mason zone. Bayer will settle things down. Plays it off the sidewall. And Vecchio kind of captains the third line, will bring it on. Drops it off. Zagatti missed that one a little bit wide. Kept in, though, by Shields. Has it along the right point. Sends that one towards the cage. And that flutters outside of the intended target. Vecchio trying to keep it in his opponent's zone. There's a shot, and it gets knocked down. Came from Bayer. Change comes for George Mason. Centering pass in front just misses towards the right as it rang the post. Jack Kelly was the one who almost got the second goal.
Mason looking very comfortable in the offensive zone right now. It's almost like they have a power play.
It's felt that way really all game.
Tough break, and they won't be able to take advantage of it. That's too bad. They had VCU going for the change.
Yeah, but they were offsides, and so a faceoff will be coming up with 7:21 remaining. Coming up during our second intermission report, we will look at some of the charitable aspects of the George Mason hockey program. They've been very active in the community and some of the great causes that they've been associated with, including the Wounded Warrior program. They do a couple of charity games a year, and we'll have a little bit more about that during our second period intermission report. Pajal will clear this one out towards center. Joyce will retreat beyond his defensive blue line, and now it'll be led ahead. Pajal, good defensive play, gets tracked down by Schaefer and then poked away by George Mason. This is Dillon trying to center in the slot, can't. Here's Gassel going for it. Gassel, the man on his side. He fires that one, and it's gloved by Catherman.
Oh,
and
Egan
now some
more friends here.
More pleasantries taking place after the save. So we've already had a couple of penalties already, matching penalties. There have been two of them so far. Are the officials going to issue anything here, or are they going to be confident that they can use just a stern talking to break everything up?
Well, you know, they were just telling each other good game. I'm sure they'll be fine.
I can't imagine you got into any of those tussles when you were playing.
Never.
As there is a look at the shot by Gassel, but right into the glove of Catherman. Approaching 6 minutes before the second period intermission. Mason up 1-0. Forrest fires, knocked down by Kraus. Kelly hits the ice. Baker, the captain, bringing it ahead. Baker fires, and that one is deflected over the screen into the mesh and out of play.
That's a great shot by Baker. Almost picked that top corner. I think he might have caught the knob of the stick by the goalie.
Some of the shots that Mason has taken tonight, they haven't had the best angles in the world.
I'll give it to the VCU defense. They are driving them outside and keeping them from those high-scoring areas.
There's a shot again by Baker, knocked down by Catherman. Fight for it along the sidewall. Mason able to keep it in. Knocked away as Cordova was in the slot. Trap has continued to work. Cordova pushes a man away, takes the puck away. Shot there. And a great save by Catherman, who had to reach back to keep it from going across the goal line.
As you can tell by that first line for Mason, they're circling the net. They're doing a great job of keeping it in the zone, and it's only a matter of time until they break Catherman down enough. Bury another one.
So both teams will make changes. Another faceoff coming up inside the VCU zone. You have to imagine Catherman is probably getting a little bit tired. Even though he's looked comfortable, he's getting a little bit exhausted. As we said, the team played a game last night in addition to tonight, and that's what a lot of times happens is you play games in back-to-back days. But the very end of the season, you have to wonder if all the time spent in goal is taking its toll. Centering feed in front, shot is no good from Halligan.
Great toe save by Kraus.
Under 5 minutes to go in the second period. Schaefer. This is Bayer with at center ice. Leaves it off for Lovejoy. Gassel trying to mix it up a little bit inside the neutral zone. Send over to Bayer. Taken away. This is Dillon. Dillon sends it across. Richard. Mason leading it the other way. Egan. Mason able to stay on sides. Out in front. And then sent towards the sideboards. Adler with it. The late offsides is called. And eventually it gets wiped out. Changes on both teams' ends. Trying to make this last 3:25 in the second count. Dillon sends it out, intercepted by Mason.
Nifty little play almost there to Guiney.
You're trying to get one more goal before you can go into that second period intermission. How do you make these last 3 minutes count?
Oh, just drive the net as much as you can. Keep the puck out of your zone. They're having a tough time doing that with VCU right now.
And that one gets put in. So VCU is able to match it as the rebound attempt goes for the Rams, and they even this game up at one.
Looks like Kraus lost sight of it. Looks like he had it in his glove, almost had it against his leg, and then they just kept pressing until they were able to bury it.
So the goal will go to Steven Davis for VCU, who's able to put the rebound in. And it's amazing, Brian, the way that those two goals almost mirror themselves.
Oh, absolutely. A lot of effort and a lot of people in confusion in front of the net. You can see right there, way too many black jerseys there. Three jerseys there compared to the one defenseman for Mason.
So Steven Davis comes up with his fourth goal of the year, the freshman from Norfolk, Virginia. So we're even at one, and suddenly things starting to get a little bit tighter for George Mason as the game gets tied up. You know, trying to win this game, not only for the seniors, but for Steve Hychek in his final game as the head coach in Mason.
Maybe a lucky break here for Sevi Cordova.
That one is fired. Catherman stops it. Sent out in front, open net, but it gets pushed wide. Under 2 minutes left to go in the period.
VCU again able to break up that play in front of the net. Catherman leading the way there.
No icing, it was deflected. Klausner dumps it into the neutral zone. Cordova has got it. He'll bring it ahead. Backhanded pass. Had a target on the far wing, but not able to find him, but it's kept in by Mason. The late offsides gets wiped out. VCU circles the wagons with 1:20 left. Zagatti, and offsides is called.
Looks like Dan Becchio didn't pick up on the signal from the referee there.
So an offsides will mean a face-off with 1:15 remaining. You have to admire the grit of VCU. Even in spite of all the chances that Mason has had in this game, VCU getting an opportunity of its own and able to capitalize.
Nice hit by Bear.
1 minute remaining in the second period. Wrist shot comes on goal. Krause able to knock it down. Ardanowski chases it down on the left wing. 43 seconds left. Vecchio will bring it up the wing. Gains the line. Looked like he might have gotten a hook. Backhanded shot is wide. And we have a whistle. And are we going to have a penalty here? It sure looked like Vecchio might have gotten hooked as he was going in on goal. Instead, the net got dislodged. That will be the call. Did you think there should have been a penalty there?
I won't give him that much credit. I think that Vecchio had it, and he might have tripped himself up there trying to cross over and get to the net.
Nonetheless, the thing that I noticed was that when that stick kind of hooks around, you're wondering if they're going to give you the call, but they don't.
It's a tough call for the refs to make there and really get a good angle on what's happening in the play. Usually they make that call when the stick comes too high up.
Adler with it at center ice. Sends it across the way. That one is fluttered in by Pejau, and then it gets gloved by Catherman.
I think what Mason's trying to do here is take advantage of those face-off wins they keep getting and try to bring it into the zone, have them save it, and be able to set up a play here for the end of the period.
A 12.8 seconds remaining. It's not quite as easy as being a college basketball coach and setting up a play with 12 seconds left.
Oh, you got to rely on winning it, and then you got to rely on the puck moving to the right people. Get one
4 seconds. It'll be Pejau, fires that one into traffic, gets pushed wide, and the second period expires. But the equalizing goal makes it a 1-1 game as Steven Davis nets one. Might have been because Krause was blocked and didn't have a very good sight at it, but either way, we're tied in the Commonwealth Cup game between George Mason and VCU going to the third period. Ryan. So it is a 1-1 game as we head into the second intermission. Jeff Arnold joined alongside by Brian Bach, and the Rams really had to do a good job on defense in that first period. In the second period, once again, it was the same. George Mason was able to use the trap to be able to get a number of other opportunities. DeVisio eventually got a shot at its own end, and they tied the game up at one.
You know, it was actually interesting to watch. VCU started to play a trap of their own. I don't know if you noticed this, but they kept keeping that center or one of their wings high. They were able to maintain pressure on Mason once they finally got it into the zone. And, you know, like we saw, they had a lot of pressure going towards the net. They had, during their goal, they actually had three people for VCU right in front of the net and only one Mason defender. I think that's what was, you know, the reason for the capitalization there.
So some work to do for George Mason in this game. One area where the team has not had to do a whole lot of work, but has rather increased its presence in the community, is the way that they have done a number of things in the community. They won a national award in 2015 for community service. They raise thousands of dollars a year for charity, and it's something that is really near and dear to Steve Hijek's heart. If you're going to come and play hockey for George Mason, you have to be an upstanding citizen.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more. It's one of those things where the team comes together and we always have great events. I think normally we raise $30,000 a year, maybe a little bit over that across two games. I was fortunate enough to play on the alumni team this year. I will mention that the alumni team did win. That was a fun game.
Did you have any goals in that game?
I did, actually. I had four goals. I scored three of them against my girlfriend's younger brother, Nick Wayland. That was pretty funny. You know, good car ride back. It was painful, though, because he told me, hey, you're welcome. And I was like, why? He goes, for letting you relive your glory years. Hurt a little bit to hear, I'll be honest.
Well, glory years makes you think that you're old. You're really not all that old, just him ribbing you a little bit. So I want to take a look at some of the video from one of the past games that George Mason played, one of the past charity games. And you noted that these games combined bring in probably about $30,000 a year or so. You get probably between $15,000, $17,000 a game or so.
It's actually great how Steve does it. So Steve, by trade, is a lobbyist, but he uses that to benefit everybody in the community. We always get corporate sponsors in there, like, for instance, Glory Day Grills, Geico. And what happens is Steve works these angles, and all of the money that gets brought into the rink goes to the charities because the ice is donated, T-shirts, you name it. And even some of the local sports teams, like the Redskins, the Washington Capitals, they'll bring in signed aficionado stuff, and we'll get a silent auction going there, which that just helps boost the money that goes to it. One of the reasons we're able to donate such a high percentage of the money to the charities.
Steve Hijack has done a great job at making sure that this team understands that being active in the community and that helping out folks in need is really something that you want to take from your college years and your hockey years into your professional life. And additionally, and the team didn't have the opportunity to do it this year, but they've actually also worked with some disabled children in teaching them how to skate, donating time to kind of get them on blades and kind of show them how to navigate the ice. And I know that's a way that a lot of the hockey players have built relationships with some younger members of the community.
Yep. So I actually loved that event. I taught skating for years professionally by trade, and it was such a great way to give back, though. We worked with a couple different organizations, and what would happen was some of the special needs parents in the area, they'd bring their children in, try to teach them how to skate, and we'd make a day of it over there at Kettler Ice Arena. Sometimes we'd get lucky enough to see some Capitals walk in and stuff like that, but it was a great overall experience and something that we did pretty much every weekend when we were home. When we had two home games, Saturday morning, Sunday morning, we'd send some players over there for the skate. Normally it'd be me, Mandeville, Baker, but the rotation really, everybody would join in. It was just a matter of, you know, who was going one week to the next.
And we said a moment ago we'd show you some video from one of the previous charity games. We're actually going to take a look at it right now in one of these former games that was played, one of the charity games here.
Today we're having our annual community fundraiser game, and we're playing the NCR Military Eagles to benefit two children's charities in our area, one of which is Our Military Kids, and the other charity is a Washington Caps organization called So Kids Camp. Our third annual community game was started 3 years ago when we had a smaller fundraiser at Kettler Arena to benefit the Bryan St. Louis Family Foundation. Last year we played the USA Warriors, which is a Wounded Warrior hockey team, to benefit Fisher House Foundation, and we raised approximately $20,000 last year. So we're hopeful to come close to that this year, and have been really proud of the things that our team has done in the community. Joined by a number of executives from the Department of Defense, to include the Assistant Secretary of the Air Force. And we hope to get about 500 people in the stands today, as well as our corporate sponsors, which include organizations such as Northrop Grumman Corporation, Textron Corporation, Geico is a sponsor for us, and they also sponsor us during the season, as does Glory Days Grill.
We'll be right back.
Turnout was awesome. We filled the stands today. I think we had 500 people in the stands, perhaps more. And as an added bonus, we had the local volunteer fire department join us for a portion of the game, and that was pretty cool for all of us. We were able to raise approximately $17,000, and those funds are going to be divided equally between the two charities.
So great coverage there of one of the previous charity games. As we noted, they raise probably about $15,000 per game. The officials donate their time. The players don't. The players come out, and various teams from the area donate memorabilia. But it's important to note too, Brian, just the cost that it takes to play college hockey. And you look at some of those numbers, and it definitely isn't cheap.
Oh, no way. You definitely spent a little bit of that summer, you know, chipping away at the bill you got to pay for Mason. I believe they're up to $1,500 to play a year now. So, you know, save up some money in the summertime, in the off season.
And that's another way that Steve Hijack has really been great, is he has helped go out, get corporate sponsors to sponsor this program so that the cost for players probably a little bit less than it would probably be a lot more if he didn't go out and be able to do that.
Yeah, I think it cuts it in half almost. I think what happens is we raise, I think, $25,000 for the team, and then he gets that match by corporate sponsorship. But, you know, it's crucial to the program because that pays for things like hotels, bus fees, everything that you don't really think about, and the ice, too. The ice, I don't know if we have a graphic on this, but I think it's like $30,000 a year for ice alone, so it's not the cheapest thing.
Yeah, $30,000 for the ice. I mean, you get to probably around like $15,000, $20,000 when you take into account hotel costs, bus costs, and there's a lot of travel along the way. And what we'll do right now is we will send it down to our ringside reporter, Tyler, who is with a special guest.
So down here ringside with the graduate students, these are these guys' last game here in a George Mason uniform tonight. So, Ryan, what does it mean having your last season with the team be in such a historic fashion that it was?
It makes me happy because I was here from the beginning when the team was not kind of at the level that they're at now. So to close out the second half of this season, take the championship, and then have the last game at home against VCU for the cup, is a good feeling. The team's come a long way, so I'm happy about it.
Okay. Now, Tyler, basically same question. I mean, what does it mean to go out on your home ice here tonight against a team like VCU?
It feels good. This team's come a long way in the past couple of years, and it's just good to get the win in the championship this year, and then hopefully also get the win tonight for the Capital Cup.
Okay, and Sevi, you've held a lot of records for this George Mason team. How are you going to get another one here tonight?
I don't know. I don't know what, right, maybe most penalty minutes. I'm not sure. Let's hope not on that one. But yeah, it was a good year, and it was a really good thing to be a part of, for sure. I think that from the beginning, you know, Steve says you want to make the team better when you leave it than when you came, and I think that for sure, everybody that's leaving this year, we're proud to say that we did for sure. So I think that's where we're at.
Okay. All right, thanks, guys. Hope you guys have a good night tonight. Good luck.
Thanks so much, Tyler. And right now, a intermission, second intermission, a 1-1 game after Virginia Commonwealth was able to score late in the second period after George Mason got a goal in the first period from Egan, was assisted by Lovejoy. And this is what you want, Commonwealth Cup game that comes down to the wire. Last year's was very lopsided, an 8-2 victory for George Mason in the game as the Patriots get ready to take the ice for the third period. And right now we'll go back down to Tyler, who is with one of the seniors tonight, Dan Gassel.
All right, here at ringside with Dan Gassel. So, Dan, how does it mean this is going to be your last game here tonight?
You know, it's tough to think about it that way, but I'm just looking forward to enjoying this last game, and hopefully we win.
What does it mean to have your senior night against VCU?
You know, it's a quite competitive game. This is our big game against them every year for the Commonwealth Cup, so it'd be nice to beat them and get that cup back.
All right, thanks, Dan.
Both teams have made their way back onto the ice. George Mason trying to see if it can capture its 17th win of the year. Will not be headed to the Atlantic Division playoffs next weekend, but still a great year after winning the BRHC Colonial a weekend ago. Defeated UNC Wilmington for the first time in program history, beat them in overtime, and then came on back to defeat Christopher Newport as Alex Mandeville ended up coming with the game-winning goal in that contest. And not only has it been a great year from a record perspective and winning a Colonial Championship, but look at all those All-Stars. Waylon Baker, Cordova, and D'Agostino will all be playing in a conference All-Star game taking place next month.
That is a lot of fun. I actually got to do that one time, and funny enough, my older brother was still in college at the time, and we got to play with each other for the first time since high school. A lot of fun. Great weekend, a lot of good players, and I think we came in third overall for the BRHC that time.
Now, did you play on the same team?
We did in high school. That was the only time that we were able to do it, and then that BRHC All-Star game.
So right now we start the third period. The faceoff is won by Mason, and it will be brought up the wing. This is Kelly trying for the backhand. He will knock that one off the glass. D'Agostino going after it, as it'll be carried along by Chris Allen. And then it will be saved by Brian Krause.
A little bit of a mix up there. I think that they thought that he kept it in his glove, but he just let the play go on.
Well, it gets knocked down, and we'll have a faceoff coming up inside the Mason zone. They were going to try and get Ryan Framignon some time, but Krause remains in goal for this third period. And the 1-1 game, you don't want to take any chances. Trying to get one more victory for Steve Hychek. Final game on the bench before handing off the reins to Morgan Muniza. What is your favorite thing, Brian, about Steve Hychek?
Oh, I don't think I can name just one.
Well, I'll let you name two.
Two, okay. So, charitable. Like we said, Steve is great about charities and giving back to the community, and it is contagious for everybody that ever hangs out with him. He always finds a way to involve you in things and give back. Other than that, you know, I'd have to go with his humbleness. He's very humble about everything he does. Like we've said, wanted no attention to the fact that this is his last coaching game. And it's amazing that he does all this for the team, all this for the program, and he wants none of the credit. He wants it all for his boys. It's great.
I'll use one more word to describe him. That's passionate. I had a conversation with him earlier in the week. We're on the phone for an hour. We talked for an hour yesterday about this game, and then we were back on the phone for another 30 minutes. He is somebody that just loves talking about hockey and explaining all the nuances of the game to you. We'll have the faceoff coming up inside the Mason zone as that one gets shuttled in on goal. We'll get down to Tyler ringside in just a moment. Richard centering pass. This will be carried up the wing as Egan tries to send it to a teammate coming up the opposite wing. This is Egan with it, the lone goal in this game for George Mason. It was banging off the sideboards. And now it'll be brought up ahead. Bayer got sandwiched, but it's kept alive by George Mason. And it will be covered up by Catherman. And now let's go down ringside to Tyler.
Interesting to note to start the third period, VCU only has 14 players that are dressed on the bench today. Mason, however, they have 20. VCU also had a game last night against Catholic, so I'm sure fatigue is going to be a huge factor here in the third period, as well as Mason. They've been off for a week, and they will have more players here at home going forward. Back to you guys.
Thanks so much, Tyler. That one by Baker went wide. He tried to send it into the slot. And now he's able to recover, will retreat beyond his own blue line before lifting it back onto center. Some action in front, but it gets knocked away. Mason tries to clear the zone, and they are able to, as will be led across by Baker. Baker, nice stick work. Up the wing, fires into the body of Catherman.
VCU doing a good job of keeping them to the outside there. Not a great chance on that shot from Baker.
Allen punches this one back behind the net where it's fielded by Kraus. And going to Tyler's point from a moment ago, the Patriots, they are playing without one of their key players tonight, Alex Mandeville. You know, they have six more players, but it's important to note that Mandeville, one of the top players on the team, while VCU, in addition to playing with 14 players, they're without two of their top offensive guys in Robbie Ehler and Phil Williams. Williams suffered a bruised lung in the game last night against Catholic, while Ehler broke his foot after the game. Talk about bad luck. And that likely means he won't be able to participate in the BRHC Atlantic tournament next week.
Broken foot is hard to play against, or hard to play with, I should say.
VCU on the attack. Shot from Ardanowski gets knocked away. Hoisted out towards center. Couldn't be handled, and Aldi be brought up the wing. Opportunity for Mason. It gets knocked down. D'Agostino taking that one in on net. This is Sevi Cordova. Centering pass. Tracked down by Egan, who fires that one into the slot, and VCU will clear the zone. Approaching 5 minutes into this third period, a 1-1 game. Fight for it out in front. Catherman, a good job to make a save.
Catherman still hasn't found the puck yet.
Centering pass, and that one is sent wide left. Graduate student showing some poise. Bear, a little bit of a poke check. Sends it up the wall, and now Egan will bring it on. Egan up the wing, gains the line, Lovejoy side saddle. This is Baker, the captain, wrister, and it's just wide. Kept alive by Egan. Baker, sent it circle to circle, has it in the corner. Comes out front. Baker, backhanded toss. No. Goal line extended. Rebound covered up by Catherman.
Mason's keeping that pressure on now in the third period. Hopefully they bag another one.
We should also note Nick Baker just attempted one of those shots. Tyler was actually able to catch up with Nick before the game.
Tyler Byram here with Nick Baker. So, Nick, final night here. George Mason as a senior. He'll be coming back as a grad student. What does it mean? What are some memories you have out here on the ice?
Probably my favorite memory was last weekend when we took home the Kelowna Division Championship. First time we ever beat CNU, and it was awesome, beat them a championship game. Definitely my best memory.
What about some memories here on your home ice?
Playing VCU is always a good memory. I mean, it's a Commonwealth Cup, definitely a competitive game. The winner gets a trophy, and it's been a competition now for about 5 years. So.
All right, good luck.
Baker, even though he is a senior, he and Mandeville will be returning next year as graduate students, as an icing means a faceoff coming up inside the VCU zone. And Brian, that's one of the things that you noted is pretty cool about playing ACHA hockey, is the opportunity to come back as a graduate student and get another year of hockey.
Oh, it's a great reward to add another year to your potential hockey career and get to stay with the team.
Guiney able to win the faceoff this time. Zagatti sends it. And the shot is knocked down in front. Second effort, fired away by VCU. Kept in the zone. Pajau for Guiney up along the half wall. Shot comes in. Catherman dives, knocks it away. Zagatti tracks it down. Zagatti trying to skid away from some pressure, knocks it behind the net. cleared on back out towards the GMU zone. And an icing will be called, so another faceoff coming up. But give a lot of credit to the Rams for being able to hang tough, especially Catherman, who really has gotten fire from every direction in this game.
Oh, he's been standing on his head for his team. He's playing great right now. VCU, I believe, was just forced to take their timeout.
And VCU will take a timeout. And while we are in that break, which is taken by the Rams, we'll send it back down to Tyler, who for the game was able to catch up with Alex Mandeville.
Tyler Byram down here with Alex Mandeville. So, Alex, unfortunately not going to be out there tonight, but what does it mean to be able to be here with your team on senior night?
Yeah, I mean, definitely important to be here, support my team. Unfortunately, I've had a strep throat for the past 3 days, so I had a pretty high fever this morning, so I figured it was best not to play. But the entire season's been great. Last weekend was definitely huge, winning the championship, so it was important to be a part of that. But unfortunately, I won't be able to play tonight. So,
yeah. What does it mean on your senior season going out in a way like this?
I think winning the championship was huge. It's something we've all been working towards since I've been with the program 4 years ago, and as long as Coach Hijack has been here as well. But, I mean, we really finished strong, and that was huge, and we got ranked in the top 15 in the region as well, which was definitely a milestone for us. And the program looks great moving forward. So,
using their lone timeout as a shot from Kelly knocked down. Catherman trying to save it out in front. And some jousting for it inside, and then it gets covered up as some more pleasantries get exchanged in what has been a very chippy game. But you and I were talking about this while Tyler was chatting with Alex earlier, is that they might have just used that timeout because they're exhausted. I mean, when you're playing with 14 guys, as Tyler just told us, you're essentially playing without a fifth of your team.
Absolutely, and one of the things that you end up, you know, doing playing against a trap like this is icing the puck fairly frequently, and those guys were out on the ice for two full shifts, and by the end of that, they absolutely had to burn that timeout.
Great chance by Kelly, but it went up into the mesh. Faceoff, though, will remain inside the VCU zone with 12:50 left. Not only are they missing players, we noted, you don't have Williams, you don't have Ehler, so you're missing two of your top players, and a real testament to the grit of this Rams team, as we did say, played last night. Klausner loops that one in. Bayer tracks it down and shovels it to the half boards. Led on ahead. This is Kelly, and an offsides is called as D'Agostino got in ahead of the puck.
I think we're pretty close to getting a call there because number two is doing some chirping on the bench for Mason.
Meanwhile, Egan mixing it up a little bit with Paul Forrest as our linesmen have to separate those two individuals. And sure enough, we will have a penalty against Forrest. The officials congregating. Is it possible here they're maybe deciding if this should be another matching penalty?
I don't think we'll see a matching penalty here. Egan, yes, was playing the big body there, trying to rough him up before they let him in the box. But I think some colorful language was used when he was over by the Mason bench, and Steve seems to be upset about it.
So for the moment, it is Forrest going into the penalty box as George Mason will go on the Glory Days Grill power play. Most of the times where we have seen penalties, it has been those matching penalties. But for right now, the Patriots will have the man advantage with 12:25 remaining in the contest. Rich Robichaud, our referee, talking things over while there's a conversation between linesman Justin Crawford and Nate Ardanowski.
The messenger. The captain normally for the team, Nick Baker here, trying to figure out what's going on. He's making a motion like number two for VCU had headbutted somebody on the bench. If that's the case and there was a headbutt,
probably an ejection.
Yeah, I think it's five in a game for that one.
Sevi Cordova having some words, it appears, with VCU players. So as it stands right now, power play chance for Mason, 12-25. The power play this year has been up and down. And here they needed to come through. As we have not yet announced the nature of the penalty. And it is a 10-minute misconduct, so that is huge. Ardanowski will bring it ahead. Had it on his stick, lost it. So a 10-minute misconduct, and that means that a long stretch of play, that's basically the rest of the game where they'll be a man down.
So they are
not
a man down.
Not a man down. Not a man down for 10-minute penalty.
They will not have him out on the ice.
But still, they are without one of their players for essentially the rest of the game. He will remain in the box, but you are right, 5-on-5.
I can see why Steve was animated then, because if it would have been a headbutting like that, which they were fairly certain that he did, it had been 5 in a game, which meant that they would have had the power play.
So essentially 13 players for the rest of this game. Centering pass out in front, knocked away. Egan tries to set it up out in front, and the shot got knocked away. If it had been a major penalty, then they would have gone on the power play, but with the misconduct, you go 10 minutes, and we're able to play 5-on-5, but tonight, a big disadvantage for VCU, has already had to expend its timeout just because it doesn't have a whole lot of players and has been down some of its key players. Looped ahead. And a whistle and a stoppage of play.
Looking like Egan's going to get a misconduct here.
So he goes to the bench. And because of the misconduct penalty, it is a penalty kill for George Mason, the Dave Stinson Geico penalty kill, with 10:44 remaining. So the faceoff is controlled by VCU, and the pass gets intercepted. Lobbed ahead. Zone is gained. Zagotti, backhanded shot, knocked down by Catherman. Klostner has it behind his own net for the Rams. Klostner sends it ahead, and then it gets taken away. This is Vecchio. Vecchio sends it into the slot and picked off by VCU. Klostner up the wing, and he sends this one off the mesh and out of play. Let's go back down to Tyler.
Okay, so I don't know if you guys saw it up there in the booth, but right in front of me when Jeff Eaton got called for that misconduct penalty, he actually turned and looked at the ref right after a hit. Now, of course, he was probably maybe a little bit extra after the VCU player went into the Mason bench. So he took a little shot at the referee, said a couple words that he wasn't supposed to say, and maybe that is why he is now sitting in the penalty box for Mason.
Thank you, Tyler. Right, he led across. Kelly with it. Sends it out to the blue line. Rister on goal, wide by Bear. Cordova trying to track it down. From the blue line, shot gets deflected out in front and will be charged ahead. Mason able to control. Bayer flips it along. Push there as it's Dillon with it. Dillon fires. Save made by Kraus. Popped up, D'Agostino. Two on two, gains the line. D'Agostino loses it though. Pushing and shoving going on with Allen. Sends this one ahead, Shields. And a good save made by Catherman.
Mason getting a lot of shots, but not so many quality shots. They're doing a good job of keeping them outside right now.
Now 8:52 remaining in this game. And a faceoff coming up in the far circle. Allen pokes it away. From behind. Schaefer. This is Shields from the blue line. A wrister knocked down in front. Good play made there by Schaefer. Gets steered out towards center. Klossner up the blue line. Tries to center. Goes up against Pajal, who's draped all over him. And Al Zagatti able to intercept. Gets turned over quickly, though. Schaefer. Backhanded out towards center. Brought up the wing. Kelly loops one on goal wide. Cordova. Out in front. Brought ahead. Player goes down. And then it gets cleared behind the Mason net.
I'm surprised that wasn't an icing call, actually.
Shot gets thrown wide. Kept alive, though, by Dillon, and his shot misses. Led up the wing, D'Agostino tried to beat his man, could not. And it's kept alive by Cordova. Out front, D'Agostino just got intercepted. Very nice play there was made by Ardanowski, who's had a good game. Baker up the blue line. Out front, knocked down. Cordova trying to get free. He fires too high. Stays in play. Fight for it. Long the near boards. Baker dumping for Lovejoy. Lovejoy sends it on goal. Rebound shot. Loose out in front. There's a pileup for it.
Puck's still loose. It's underneath.
Still loose. Cordova poked it away. They didn't stop play. And then this one will get sank the length of the ice. So icing is the call. Faceoff coming up inside the VCU zone. And an exhausted Catherman somehow able to keep this game tied. 6:15 remaining. Saying that he has stood on his head in this game, an understatement.
Mason putting on the pressure, but unfortunately, Jeff Egan, that big player in front, took that misconduct, so he'll be sitting in the bench or sitting on the in the penalty box for a while now.
Now, the misconduct, we thought at first it was just a simple penalty kill, but a misconduct is both teams have a player in the box on account of that. Shields sends it up the wing. On for Zagatti. Taken in. Fight for it. Allen goes down. Gets centered. Shields with it. Sends it across. Wrister knocked down by Catherman. Klossner retrieves. Now there's a fight for it behind the net. Kelly tracks it down in his defensive zone, and change is coming for George Mason. Lovejoy bringing it up the wing. Lovejoy leaving behind. Shields fires, deflected and sent wide. Cordova is able to recover. Pass gets knocked away in the slot. up the left wing. Out of control, it was Arnowski. Here comes D'Agostino trying to put a move on a defender.
That's got to be a penalty.
He gets sent down.
They'll give him either a hold there or a hook.
It's one of the two, and oh my, an extra push on D'Agostino after the whistle blew. So a penalty against VCU in what has been a game littered with penalties called. And now a power play coming up for George Mason as Dylan will go to the box. Let's go down to Tyler.
Okay, now let's keep in mind this is senior night, so let's take this time to talk about one of the seniors. He may not be the most talented guy on the roster for George Mason, but Dan Gassel has been a huge part for George Mason this year. He knows his role on the team, and for a majority of the season, the gas man has played primarily on the third line, except as a key role player. Role player for George Mason, meaning that they are able on two dice when the first and second line players need a break at key points in the game. Now, although this game comes with some frustration for Gassel, he has embraced this role quite well for the team, and he was a huge part of the team's win over Christopher Newport in the BRHC championship. While he may be on the third line, he is a very hard competitor and is heavily relied on when it comes to the penalty kill. Now, other three seniors on the team for George Mason, Gassel is going to be the only one that will not be returning to George Mason as a graduate student. So this will be the last game in uniform for Dan Gassel here tonight.
All right, Tyler, thanks. And it's all hands on deck with 4:38 remaining in the game. A 1-1 contest. But, you know, Brian, a goal might be coming our way soon because it has been at about this time in the first and second periods where a goal was scored. Mason getting one home in the first period and then VCU countering in the second. Face-off is won by the Patriots, and Zagatti will retreat to track down the puck.
Mason needs to get in and set up their power play here and take advantage of this while they can.
Set things up here for Seve Cordova. Now out in front, Baker, a wrist shot, knocked down in front. Great defensive play made by Chris Allen to assist Catherman, and it gets sent the length of the ice. So Dylan called for holding. Minute 18 on the power play left for George Mason. This might be its shot. Remember, if we have overtime at this level, you'll go to 4-on-4 for 5 minutes, and then it would be a shootout. Lovejoy in the slot. Got knocked off of his stick. Allen takes a spill, and play gets stopped.
Seemed to be some miscommunication there when the puck got sent down to Brian Krause. It seems like Nick Baker wasn't communicating with him, and there's a bit of a mishap where VCU almost had a shorthanded goal.
So VCU, 13 players, trying to hang tough on the road for going to his conference tournament next week. Got a win last night over Catholic, 6-3, but no Ehler, no Williams. Player with a misconduct right now, and still they have held tough, and Catherman, for my money, has been the MVP so far for VCU. Zagatti sends that one on goal. Comes back now to Tarek Zagatti. In the corner. Looking to center.
Very aggressive penalty kill there by VCU. They're able to get Seve Cordova alone and then move the puck out.
Lovejoy up on the wing. Had Cordova in the slot, but it was knocked away. The pass also led Cordova too far. 2:45 remaining. Baker fires. That one knocked down in front. Rebound chance steered away by Lane.
And we're even here. They're trying to take advantage of that man who just left the box.
2.5 minutes left, and an icing call will mean a face-off in the VCU zone.
VCU referees watching the game nice and close, unable to get that change.
And of course, and not able to do that It was close to almost being able to happen before the icing was called, but didn't get it quite in time.
That's tough with those 13 guys, too, because you're looking to make changes as soon as possible.
Another face-off won by George Mason. Pajal with it at center ice. Dumped in for Guiney. Guiney might have been tripped.
That
and then it got hammered
hit.
Against the boards, and this will be a penalty against VCU. Delay penalty is the call as some fans scream and shout. Holly Benton, that's the alumni. Centering pass knocked away, and now the penalty will be assessed against the Rams.
Guiney looks pretty shaken up there. Not sure exactly what they're going to call. Charge, roughing, or hitting, checking from behind. Any way you do that, though, that was a really dirty hit.
So a bad penalty by VCU. Ardnowski, a freshman. It'll be penalties like this that I'm sure his head coach Michael Fish will be talking to him about after the game, but that is devastating with 1:57 left.
That's the rest of your game right there.
So you wouldn't have him back unless you get to overtime.
Looks like they did just get back number two, though, who took a misconduct earlier.
And that was Paul Forrest, of course. So it is a Glory Days Grill power play for George Mason with just under 2 minutes remaining in the game. And it is a boarding penalty. Led on, D'Agostino. Good luck at the goal. D'Agostino fires, and a great save by Catherman. Punched out towards the slot, and then it gets volleyed ahead.
VCU again with that pressing forecheck, despite not having their full man advantage.
Baker sends that one on. Catherman, another good save. Rebound attempt can't be put back. This is Baker, the captain, with it. So we approach 1 minute to play. Cordova taking it in. Turns with it. Deals back to Baker. Baker, Cordova. He fires off the top of the goalpost and out of play.
Sevy's known for that shot, that far corner shot.
An off top shelf, and he just barely missed finding Twine. 52.4 seconds remaining. So remember, you will not get Ardanowski back. Tie up for it. D'Agostino keeps it in. Here's Baker. Cordova backhands it. Kelly controls. 40 seconds left.
Again, we see them with that aggressive penalty kill.
D'Agostino misses it wide.
That's another post.
Baker, second chance is good! D'Agostino gives the lead to George Mason with 28.1 seconds left.
Beautiful goal. Beautiful goal in the right place at the right time. Baker with a nice shot. D'Agostino there to pick up the rebound.
D'Agostino got the look, sent it into the back of the net. As you take a look at that big goal with time winding down.
Baker, great move, keeping the puck low so it can bank off that far pad. D'Agostino just waiting for it.
So D'Agostino coming up with a big play. 28.1 seconds left.
No breath of relief yet.
First Mason goal since the very end of the first period. Limited time left for VCU. They have 19 seconds to play with.
And the goalie has left the net for VCU. They get that extra player. Mason fighting to get control of the puck.
Flipped along. This is Forrest. And it's knocked out of play. Comes back towards center ice. And a faceoff with 5.2 seconds remaining. And Tyler D'Agostino, the freshman from Brooklyn, the BRHC Rookie of the Year, showing why he got that honor, coming through in the guts of the game. So we've got a face-off coming up here. Mason has won them all day.
Mason that fell on it. There you go. Just enough.
And that's it. So at the very end of the game, Tyler D'Agostino comes up with the game-winning goal. And for the third year in a row, the Patriots will hoist the Commonwealth Cup and send Steve Hijack with a hug and a trophy into retirement after a fantastic career as the head coach of the Patriots. An unreal finish. You wouldn't expect anything less from a Commonwealth Cup game.
All the way down to the wire, VCU fielded a much better team this year, was able to hold Mason to a one-goal lead and then tie it in the second. Great game. All smiles from the coaching staff on George Mason here, though.
So back-to-back weeks, the Patriots get some hardware. Last week, taking the BRHC Colonial for the first time. They've gotten used to holding on to the Commonwealth Cup, though, for the third straight year. It will remain with George Mason, a 17-13-1 record. As you look once again at the goal that was able to win it for Mason.
Smart play by D'Agostino. He circled around, found himself some open ice there. Nobody nearby for just the tap-in. He could have had a putter there. It was amazing.
So there the celebration as he puts it home. Steve Hijack gets some hugs from all his players as he congratulates everybody. And I don't think he could have imagined winning a game to end his coaching career in a better fashion. As he came into this game, saying to me beforehand, he's like, we better win this one. And Steve Hijack gets a win in his final game as the Patriots head coach. So there'll be a trophy presentation as George Mason will be able to sip from the Commonwealth Cup. It will remain in their hands for another year, and there it is. They've got it. They're raising it as everyone in a yellow jersey trying to get a hand on it. They had to earn this one. Everybody posing for pictures as there it gets hoisted up high. Sevi Cordova, the alternate captains, joining the fray. And one more picture. This looks like the same exact pose for Steve Hijack after winning the game last week.
What a great way to go out of his career. Great man. Did great things for the entire program. Got two trophies to end it.
And after last week's game, felt great. This one also has to for Steve Hijack, who will walk the cup out towards center ice, taking it towards all the alumni in attendance. And a big win for Steve Hijack, carrying that trophy in his left arm while he gets plenty of handshakes. And something tells me it's going to be a fun night for Steve Hijack and the rest of this Patriots team, celebrating a huge win over rival VCU.
And a huge season. What a great year for Mason Ice Hockey. To their second year in the Colonial, and to go that far, to win the championship, to take the Commonwealth Cup like this. What a strong team they fielded this year, and I hope they're able to bring that back next year.
And we're taking a look at the first goal that scored. That was from Egan. And then VCU was able to tie up the game late in the second period. Before in the third, it was Tyler D'Agostino goes by Dags, giving his team the game-winning goal with 28 seconds remaining.
Love the celly.
So there's Sevi Cordova. Cordova getting a hug, the graduate student. Fantastic career at George Mason. Program leader in goals, over 100 for his career. And plenty of celebrations plan for the rest of tonight as a big win for the Patriots here at the PWI Center.
I'll tell you, though, D'Agostino, considering the year he had, his first year, he's going to take Seve Cordova for a run for his money.
So a big win tonight for the Patriots. They're able to get the Commonwealth Cup. Jeff Arnold joined alongside by Brian Bach. And the thing that I admire the most about VCU, they were playing for, you know, really a time with 13 players when you consider that misconduct that took place in that third period, and Catherman was under fire the entire game.
Catherman had an unreal game.
He really did, and it's such a shame for his case, because he really played very gutsy hockey in goal, but at the end, George Mason eventually found a way.
I'm a bit biased there. I'm really happy to see them take that win and go home with a cup and take a win for Steve Hijack here, leave with a cup. And again, showing the footage here, D'Agostino with that smart turnaround to find himself some open ice and then bury it back door. And a great Selly. I'll give him that. Great Selly. Like I was saying, though, he's going to take Cordova for a run for his money for all those goals. I'm just going to fade away into history here. Used to have it. Now Seve has it. I think D'Agostino will take it, though. He's a great player.
Yeah, he's a great player. Only a freshman. The conference's freshman of the year is there's Dan Gassel after the game coming to a close, posing for pictures. One of the couple of seniors honored before the game. And Castle will go into a career in law enforcement after the year is over for him.
I believe he'll be walking in the spring and move on to be one of the men in blue.
President of Phi Cap. Nickname is the Gas Man. Player that provided plenty of energy and enthusiasm during his time here at George Mason.
One of the things that we'll all remember about Daniel Gassel is that no matter what, if there was a man standing back door, he would yell back door. And it was funny because he always, when he first came to the team, he still had his accent, his New England accent. So every time he would yell it, be like, back door, back door. And throughout his entire career with Mason Hockey, we've all kind of chirped him and made fun of him for it. But he's a great player, and we saw it tonight, too. All over the ice, a grinder, chirping away, took a penalty, you know, high-emotion game for him, being his last game, but great guy, great player.
And somebody that everybody on that Mason Hockey team is sure going to miss, but the nice thing about it, and you could just sort of see it in the ceremonies that took place before the game, is that you may no longer be able to put all the pads on. But even when you leave the Mason Hockey program, you never really leave the Mason Hockey program.
Oh, no. We still get called in to do charity events, things like that. And then even the alumni game, which we do at least once a year.
So the big win for seniors like Dan Gassel and this Patriots team. They close the year 17-13-1 as they defeat VCU, take the Commonwealth Cup. Thanks to the late goal by Tyler D'Agostino with under 30 seconds remaining in the game. Thanks to everyone on our production tonight. For Tyler Byram and Brian Bach, Jeff Arnold saying so long from PWI Center. The George Mason Patriots take the Commonwealth Cup for the third straight year.